Hello, shooting fans, and welcome to the finals hall here at the Thayer de Tiro Juan Carlos Primero shooting range, where we're kicking off the excitement with 50-meter rifle three positions men. I'm Hillary Russell and have the pleasure of having Great Britain's rifle shooter and head rifle coach at West Virginia University, Jonathan Hammond, here with me today. Welcome, Jonathan, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me again.
It's been great. You've been by my side a couple times this week, and you're full of knowledge, and it's going to be a great final today.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like a pro now doing this a few times. I think it'll be a great final today. This is sort of seen as maybe the premier event in rifle, the men's three-position match. We've got some incredible shooters today, and it should be a great final.
In just a couple seconds, we're going to be able to introduce our eight fine finalists. Qualifications went very well for these guys. We do have quota places that are involved today, and I'll explain that to you in just a couple minutes. On firing point A, representing the Russian Federation, we have Sergei Kamenskiy.
Yeah, Kamenskiy won one of the World Cups this year in Maribor, and he also just set the world record in the prone match, so we'll be expecting some good prone shooting from him today.
On firing point B, representing Italy, you don't really have to introduce him, everybody knows him, Niccolo Campriani.
Yeah, don't think we need to say too much about Campriani. He's the Olympic champion at the moment. You know, he's been one of the best shooters in the world for the last few years. And obviously for me, was a student with us in West Virginia. So we know Nico really well, and great to see him in the final today.
On firing point C, representing Belarus, we have Vitaly Bubnovich.
Yeah, Bubnovich, like the last final, is the oldest competitor at 39. And I think this is his third final. So he's made all three finals here this week. Just incredible shooting to be that consistent in all the events.
On firing point D, representing the People's Republic of China, we have Xu Qinan.
Xu, he's probably been one of the best air rifle shooters ever, almost. But he's really come on in three position in the last, quite a while. I mean, he's a great shooter as well. So see if he can add to his resume today.
On firing point E, representing the Russian Federation, we have Nazar Luzhenets.
Well, we've got Luzhenets in here who broke the world record this year, or equaled the old world record, and set it for himself with 11.86. So another excellent addition to the final.
On firing point F, representing the Ukraine, we have Serhiy Kulish.
Kulish is the youngest competitor today. See there, just age 21. Still has a lot of experience. He's very competitive in 2012 and 13, and haven't seen as much of him this year, but he's also a really strong shooter.
On firing point G, representing Norway, we have Ari Hansen.
Hansen, another one, very experienced. I shot a lot with him back in the juniors a long time ago. Another strong air rifle shooter, but he's really been shooting some good 3P in the last 3 or 4 years also.
And on firing point H, representing the Republic of Korea, we have Han Jin-seop.
Han is actually the silver medalist from the last World Championships, so he'll be looking to maybe go one further. See on the screen there, a lot of silver medals, and I'm sure he'd love to push that one further and take the gold.
So, Jonathan, just take a minute and explain what we're going to be seeing today. What does this final consist of?
So we're going to have the three-position final for the men. We're actually going to shoot all three positions. You can see them on the screen. They're in the kneeling position right now. They're going to shoot a total of 15 shots kneeling, 15 shots in prone, and then anywhere from 10 to 15 shots in the standing position. So they're going to go through the whole set of the three positions like they did in the match. Slightly different format. They're just taking their positions right now, and they're going to get 3 minutes and 20 seconds for a series of 5 shots, and then they're going to do that 2 more times in kneeling and the same in prone. So they're a little bit on the clock. There's a little bit more pressure when you have that time, and shooting 5 shots at a time, it's not a 3 minutes and 20 seconds isn't a whole lot of time for kneeling, but we're essentially going to see the whole format and them go through all the positions.
Now, the pressure of the quota places has been taken off of all these guys' shoulders for this, which is really great. There were 5 quota places that were allocated for this event, and Kamenskiy Bubnovich and Luzhinets have already won one for themselves and for their country. And so all the other five finalists, before even entering into the final, have won the quota places to the 2016 Rio Games.
Yeah, that's a huge weight to be lifted off their shoulders. You know, so much of the World Championships and leading into next year is about winning those quota places for the Olympics. So, you know, although those three shooters won them in either air rifle or prone already, once you've won a quota place, you're not eligible to win another one. So those three shooters, they still may be able to shoot the three-position event in Rio, but they won't be able to win another quota place. So the other five, there we see Campriani on the screen. I know he was very relieved and happy to go into the final, knowing that that quota was already taken care of. And it allows them just to go and enjoy the final, and they're competing to be the world champion now and not worrying about getting that quota place for Rio.
Campriani starting off with a 9.1. And we might just add quickly that Campriani's girlfriend, Petra Zublesing, she is the 2014 world champion of the women's 3P event.
No, air rifle.
Air rifle, sorry.
Yeah, they're, you know, usually Nico's been winning the air rifle and Petra's been winning the three position and maybe doing a little switch here today, but yeah, I know she'll be down there supporting him, and I'm sure he'd love to add this, having after her success in the air rifle.
Let's focus in now on shoot.
So yeah, we can just see on the bottom of the screen there, they'll go through their five-shot series. We've got Bubnovich there, started off with an 8, so not the way you want to start. You know, still plenty of time for them to claw it back, and I think Kneeling, they all shot incredible scores today. I think to make the final today took an 11.77, which is just crazy scores. You know, we've got to expect it. It's the World Championships. It's probably the toughest match that we shoot with the quality of the field. But still, 11.77 would quite often win you World Cups. Now it's just getting you into the final. So I think if we're seeing them shoot, you know, bad nines and certainly eights, it's just purely down to nerves with the situation, the time pressure. I mean, they were all shooting incredible scores in the match. So, it's, you know, they're Hansen there starting off with a 51.4. That's a great start for him. You know, anything really in and around the 51 mark, they'll be pretty satisfied with, especially in this situation. And those that are able to consistently shoot 51s and above will definitely build a little bit of a lead after Kneeling, I think.
In the kneeling position, John, let's just talk about it physically. What happens to you after being in this kneeling position? They have to shoot three series of shots, and you have to be holding yourself extremely steady. And tell me what it feels like.
Well, you know, your foot can get a little bit sore after you've been kneeling on it for a while, but you should be pretty relaxed. You want to find a position where you're just, you know, sat on that kneeling roll, just sat down, really comfortable, really relaxed. It's not as stable as prone. The only contact you have is as you can see there, their left arm is on their left knee for the right-handers. The right arm's floating a little bit. So it's quite delicate. It's a very fine position. Got to be balanced right and just be able to sit there steady.
So let's just take a look at the standings now. After the first series of shots in the kneeling position, we have Hansen in first place by 7/10 of a point over Shu. Kamenskiy is in third place. He's 9/10 of a point behind. And really, you know, all the others are just a mere 10th, 3/10. Anything can happen. This is only just the first series, and we are going to be going into the other positions, so it's way too early to call anything.
Yeah, really, really close there. I'm surprised that six of them are all below 50, but they're all in the 49s there. Hansen's definitely got a nice little lead after that first set, but we can actually just see there in the graphic, the wind flags are moving a little bit. We can't see from our position here, but it's obviously a little bit windy down there, and that'll have a big impact. When they shot their qualification match this morning, conditions were pretty favorable. It was definitely, you know, pretty tranquil on the range. The wind flags weren't doing a whole lot. Certainly while they were shooting kneeling and prone, maybe standing, it picked up a little bit. So if it's now a little bit windy, it's a very different situation than what they shot this morning. So that's possibly going to, plus, you know, nerves added into it a little bit. But like you said, they're all pretty close together still.
So let's just talk about an open range. You know, there are some finals hall that have a closed-in range. And generally, every shooting range that I've gone to, the qualification range, that is where it's open. And then they can go into, like in Beijing, let's say, it's a closed range.
Sure. Yeah, it's strange, really. I mean, I think, you know, part of our sport is about shooting in the wind and dealing with the conditions and either waiting for a shot or having to aim off. Oh wow, we just had a 10.9 from Hansen. We can see on the screen there, Han with a 10.7 to start. Bubnovich shooting a 10.8. So
things are settling down.
Yeah, they're starting to get dialed in a little bit. But yeah, the indoor finals hall, I mean, they're really nice, but it's a very different situation from how they shot the qualification match. So as a shooter, I really like to see this outdoors. It could be tricky. With it being a smaller range, the wind might get in and swirl around a little bit. So it's definitely a bigger test for the shooters. There's going to be some shooters that enjoy that challenge and enjoy that test, and probably the more experienced shooters that are more experienced at dealing with conditions will fare better. Once you go into an indoor finals hall, you know, you can forget the conditions of how they were during the match, and you're just, you know, shooting straight and not worrying about wind. So it definitely is a different situation. And there, Kulish with a 10.8 and stringing some 10s together, and I think finishing with just waiting for him to finish his last shot. Hansen getting a 50.8 in, to so he's keeping a 51 average that's probably going to keep him up at the top. There were Campriani, a couple 10s. Not a bad little group. He'll probably want to finish off with a solid 10 to finish.
And Hansen with that 10.9, that does definitely help things out.
Absolutely.
He did have a 9.6 in that series as well, but can't do anything better than a 10.9.
Yeah, they're certainly settling down. I think it looks like that most of them are shooting better on that this second series. We had six of them shooting in the 49s, and it looks like Campriani shooting a 49.9, but the rest of them look like they're all going to be above 50. That's a good shot of Kamenskiy there. Don't know if he's looking at his monitor a little bit. Probably checking the wind, and they may have to wait a little bit with the wind and really watch the wind flags and wait for their sort of whatever wind they're shooting on, if the flags are up or down, and sort of picking their moment to shoot.
So let's just take a look once again. After the second series, we have Hansen still holding on to first place by a half a point over Shu. Kamenskiy in third place, a point behind Shu. Luzhinets in fourth place, only 0.2 behind, and really putting the pressure on him. And the following athletes are really very close together at this point. We still have one more series in the kneeling position. They'll be moving on over to the prone position. And during that time, that it'll be a changeover time where they will, well, actually, Jonathan, you can say what they're going to be doing.
Yeah, well, they're going to have a 7-minute changeover time, so they're not going to be a whole lot of time, and they're going to have to completely change over for the prone position. Not only that, the 7 minutes also includes their cider time. So the quicker they get changed over, the more time that they're going to have for their cider shots. So they shouldn't be thinking about it right now. They've still got 5 shots of kneeling to shoot, but they may just be, as soon as they finish that last shot, they might be getting into changeover mode and just going, all right, let's get my order. What am I going to change first? Sights off, butt plate off, all that kind of stuff.
So. And we'll have a chance to see that and see exactly how much racing around is going on. And you can almost feel the stress level of the athletes during that time.
So yeah, we've got Campriani down at the bottom there. He shot a 397 today in the kneeling part of the qualification, which is just, you know, incredible kneeling. So I know he'll want to pick it up a little bit for this final set and not give himself too much of a hole going into the prone and the standing part.
And Campriani, what would you say he's strongest in which?
Well, you know, I think it's standing. You know, he was won the world championships 4 years ago in air rifle, won an Olympic medal in air rifle in London. But he's really developed as a three-position shooter as well. So when we get to 3P, I think standing's still typically his stronger position. But he, you know, I know firsthand, you know, he's worked incredibly hard to develop his prone and his kneeling, and here we see him in the final as well.
Kamenskiy having a really good...
Yep, good start there, 10-5, 10-3. You know, it's almost a kneeling. They're looking just to almost stay in it, and, you know, they want to shoot as well as they can. You can build a good lead, but, you know, just keep it consistent, you know, keep it consistent through prone, and then really standing will sort of decide everything at the end.
Nice, 10.8 for Kamenskiy.
Hansen's already finished.
He's a fast shooter, that's for sure.
So there we go, 51.6 for him in that series, giving him a 153.8. So nice and consistent, averaging above 51. he'll be pretty happy with that. Hansen's a really strong standing shooter too, so he'll be looking just to continue that through prone and get into standing. So here we see Campriani, one more shot to go. We definitely want to get a 10 in here to finish and get on with prone. A few 9s there, but 9-9 doesn't hurt you too much. So it's a 10, but only a 10-0. Not super happy with that. Bubnovich here.
A nice 10.8 there, but 9.1 to start off is not really where you want to be at. Finishing off with a 10.4.
Yeah, that certainly helps him. Pulled him up a little bit. And just waiting for Kamenskiy to finish. This definitely looks like it's going to be... if he shoots a
nice.
10, there we go. Oh, a little fist pump already. So yeah, 52.6. That's definitely the highest series of 5 shots out of everyone today. So it's pulled him up the leaderboard quite a bit, I think.
And Hansen is still holding on to first place, still with a half a point. Kamenskiy has now overtaken Xu. And Xu is now down by 7/10 of a point. Following him, we've got Han. He's 1.4/10 of a point behind. Kulich is in fifth. Bubnovich is in sixth. Lu Jeanette's in seventh. And Campriani is down by half a point under Lu Jeanette's.
Yeah, I think Kamenskiy was probably the biggest mover there on that last series. And he's obviously motivated. You saw there a little fist pump. And I think after setting the world record in prone with an incredible 632 point something, I can't quite remember, he then ended up fourth in the prone final. So, you know, you're happy to win a quota place, but I'm sure after shooting such a great match, to not come away with a medal in that final was a little bit disappointing. So, you know, he's probably in here looking to make up for that and see if he can come away with a medal from these world championships.
So we've got Xu Qinan right now doing the changing over. Tell us what is he doing?
So they've got this lovely little plastic box for all their stuff that they have to keep it all in. They're probably just changing their whole rifle over. They're going to most likely have 3 sets of sights, 3 butt plates, 3 cheek pieces, different hand stops. So the positions are very different. The position that you're shooting kneeling is completely different from the one that you're shooting prone. So they want to change everything over. You can see him just sort of changing the sights. The butt plates and the cheek pieces are obviously, we're in a different position. We've gone from kneeling up to lying down, so the head position in relation to the body is quite different. The sights, though, you know, again, we might have different riser blocks and make the sights a little bit higher or lower, so your impact point is going to be different. So if you don't change your sights, your first shot in the next position could be in the 0 or the 5 ring, and then you've got to take a lot of time adjusting your sights. So they're probably going to put a completely different set of sights on, and that'll going to be their prone sight, and hopefully their first shot's going to be right in and around the 9 or a 10. So I think this is Han here with the old woodstock. See, that's his prone hook now is a lot higher than where his kneeling hook would have been. And, you know, they're getting their prone mats out there. They'll get their stand out of the way. I think that's Campriani there. You can see his recognize the rifle and pair of trousers. So he's getting his different rear sight on. He's got a lot of stuff stripped off the rifle there to try and rebuild it, essentially.
Now, we were talking the other day during the women's 3P event about when you're getting nervous, generally what happens to a lot of people is that their hands start shaking.
Yeah.
And so you've got these tools that you're changing around all the equipment, and they're small pieces.
It's tough. You know, you got to, that's a small part of it too, is just staying calm and, you know, tiny little wrenches and fiddling with, you know, changing the sights on and off. And, you know, 7 minutes isn't a whole lot of time. Just looking at the clock, we've got just under 4 minutes left. A couple of those guys are already getting in position. I think that's Coolish there. So he's already in position, getting settled. You know, he's going to be fine and get plenty of sighters in. Some of them are still standing up, wandering around, getting their stuff out. There's Kamenskiy adjusting his sling. So there's another change. His sling is going to be different for prone than what it was in kneeling. Then going into standing, they're going to have to take the sling off the jacket altogether.
And do you think that both women and men, 3P athletes, do you think they're practicing this constantly to try to make the time a little bit shorter?
I don't know if it's constantly, but you have to practice the finals. You know, you definitely have to practice them. You know, you can be the best shooter in the world, and if you screw up the changeover and don't get enough sighters in, you know, you've lost an opportunity. So they'll definitely practice these changeovers. I think when these new rules came in last year for all of us, it was a rush. It was a bit of a struggle. I could barely change all my stuff over in 7 minutes, never mind get any sighter shots in. So, you know, we certainly probably weren't too fond of the rule change when it first happened. Now it's something that the shooters have just had to get used to. So like you said, yeah, we've got to practice it. So I'm sure all of these guys will have taken just a little bit of time before, you know, either in the winter or certainly coming into a big event like this, where they've practiced their finals and practiced the changeovers. You know, take 7 minutes, change over, shoot a few shots, do the next changeover, and just repeat that process. So,
how risky is it, Jonathan, if you don't even have a chance to have one sighting shot?
Well, I mean, really risky. You could risk that first shot could go anywhere. You have no idea. So, more than likely, it's going to, you know, be in the center. We can see on our monitors, you know, Kamenskiy's banged in a couple 10.5 right away. So he's right there. Luzhinets and Kulish have been a little bit further away, so they might need a few more shots to get centered. Everyone's fired at least one shot now, other than Campriani. We're just under 2 minutes left, so you know, even Nico's going to get a couple shots in. I think he's down in position. There's Kamenskiy on screen. You know, he's already shot 3 tens in a row. So you know, once they're sighted in, they're probably going to take some time just to relax. There we've got Han on the screen. He's been one of the best prone shooters in the world for quite a while. Really solid. Plenty of prone medals. So it'll be interesting to see if he can make up a little bit of ground or just stay where he is.
Now, there is a whole science behind this shooting that people that don't know this event or the sport should know about, and that has to do with breathing and, you know, your heartbeat and your pulse and everything.
Well, you want to be relaxed. You know, you want to be, in order for the rifle and your hold to be as steady as possible, you have to be relaxed, have to be settled. So it's, you know, you might use the breathing as a little bit of sort of meditation when you first get into position, just to relax yourself, calm yourself down. You know, it's not quite as crazy as the biathlon guys that ski in and have to slow their heart rate really quickly. But, you know, these changeovers, it's, you know, a little bit of similarity there. You know, they've been rushing around, changing their gun over. They've dropped down. They might have just had, you know, we're at 30 seconds left now. They might have had just a couple minutes to slow that heart rate back down, calm themselves so that that gun is perfectly steady and they can shoot the best shots that they can. So these guys have obviously practiced. Everyone's had, you know, that's Nico's fourth sighter. Everyone else is at 5 or 6 sighters. So it's more than enough time to get sighted in. But, you know, a year ago, this would have been a lot different. So I think people have definitely practiced these finals and the changeovers to, in order to be able to compete.
Absolutely, and I think that you can see that also with the scores. If you were to compare them to last year's scores compared to this year's, it does seem like people are really, both men and women, are beginning to get into how they have to set themselves up and how they have to organize themselves so they do have that time to do the sighting shots. So again, we're going to be going into 3 series once again of 5 shots, all in the prone position. And after that, there'll be another change over time, and then we'll be going into the standing positions.
Yeah, they'll get a little bit less time for prone. It's only going to be 2.5 minutes for each 5-shot series. So you're looking at a 30 seconds a shot average, which is the same as the prone final. So it's not a lot of time, but it's comfortable. The big challenge will be if the wind changes. If the wind's switching back and forth or changing, they're not going to have time to probably wait for it. They may just have to aim off to one side, change their shading a little bit. So that'll be a challenge. We can't see from the screen what the wind's like, but there's a great 10.7 from Kamenskiy to start off with. So I think anything above 52 in each series and over a sort of 104 average is going to be pretty solid, and they'll be happy with. Someone may, you know, shoot something really high, and obviously, you know, below that, you're probably going to be losing some ground. So there's Hannah, 9.8, backed it up with a 10.7 right away. So 3 more tens and keep him on a good score.
Also, Schuster, enough the 9.8, bouncing back up into the 10 ring with a 10.5.
Yeah, you don't want to shoot too many nines in prone. They're all capable of shooting 15 tens, but again, you know, that heart rate may still be up a little bit. This is the final of the World Championships, so it's not just a casual day of practice. And two, the conditions add into that as well. So there's a lot of things going on for them think about. So Kulish with three tens, four tens, and we've also got Han backing up that 10-7 with a 10.9. So those two will really help him out.
And Campriani with a 10.8, that's going to help things out for him as well.
So yeah, they're really, you know, if they can shoot a couple of these really, you know, high tens, 10-7, 10-8, 10-9, you know, a couple of those can really change your score quickly.
There you go, 10.8.
Two 10.8s for Nico in a row, and that's going to be a big help. And equally, there's Hansen. You know, he's got four tens, but they're 10-0s, 10-1s. You know, only a 50.1 there, so he actually shot higher than that in all three of his dueling series. He won't be too happy with that, and was probably just taking a little break there. He's strong in standing, so he'll want to just not give up too much in prone. And a 10.5 for Campriani to finish, so a good solid 52.3 for him will hopefully help him out.
So things have changed now once we've gotten to the prone position. We've got Kamenskiy, who has overtaken Hansen by 8 tenths of a point. We have Shu in third place, 4 tenths of a point behind him. Han in fourth place, 8 tenths of a point behind. And we've got tied up for fifth place, Bubnovich and Kulish. Luzhinets is holding on to seventh place. He's a point, 1.3 tenths of a point behind Bubnovich and Kulish. And Campriani is still holding on to eighth place, but only 1 tenth of a point behind Luzhinets.
Yeah, Campriani making up a bit of the deficit there, but really tight in the middle. Bubnovich with the highest one on equal with Campriani on 52.3. So moved him up a little bit. And those guys in the middle, they're all really, really close. So see if anyone can shoot you know, some really high, you know, if anyone can shoot a 53 in prone, you know, that's really nailing them right in the middle and definitely catch up some ground.
Luzhinets starting off with a 10.2.
Luzhinets there with an interesting little thing on his pistol grip supporting his hand. I've not seen that before. Then we've got Bubnovich, 10.2 to start. Another Bliker on the screen here. We'll see a lot of Blikers out here.
Kamenskiy and Campriani starting off in the nine ring. That's not where they want to be.
Yeah, the same with Hansen. So a few more nines on this one. They won't want to give up too many nines. There we've got Han. Quite a low position for him, too. You can see the butt plate's really high up in his shoulder and gun's really low. So, yeah, there's a variety of positions to look at, too. You know, they vary quite a lot. Everyone has slightly different positions that work for them. Oh, 10.9 from Zhu.
I know. Beautiful. 10.6, 10.9, down to 10.0. Let's see what the next shot's going to be.
So he's still got a good group going. Hansen there coming back from that 9.3 with a couple 10.6s. He want to finish off strongly. Another Bliker on the screen. So we've got a lot of really good standing shooters in here, and I think all of them had to shoot incredible standing just to make the final. So, you know, it's almost just jostling for position right now and then seeing what can happen when they get into standing. But there's another nine from Campriani. You don't want to leave yourself too much ground to make up. Campriani, like anyone, is capable of doing that, but you'd definitely rather be in the top three or four going into standing. Kamenskiy with a solid group there. It's coming out to 52.1. And we've got a few more 52s in this group, one from Kulish as well. This is the last shot from Campriani.
Nice, 10.7 for Campriani. Kamenskiy holding on. Kamenskiy's holding on to first place by 1.1 tenth of a point over Shu, who has now overtaken Hansen and is holding on to second place. Hansen is tied up with Kulish. They're 7 tenths of a point behind Shu. And let's just take a look at, we've got Campriani. He's now 1.1 tenth of a point behind. It's still, like you were saying, these guys are super great standing shooters, and things could change around. They will have two sets of two series in standing that they'll have to shoot. And after that, then 7th and 8th place will be eliminated. Do you think that Campriani can make it up?
He can. He'll have to shoot. You know, we'll see what happens in the last prone series. Yeah, they can all make it up, but it's going to be a hard ask. certainly easy to fall out of the top few if you shoot a bad series. But we've got eight really amazing shooters in here, so they're not all going to be giving up ground easily. So, you know, the top few definitely are in a good position right now. Kamenskiy, Shu, Hansen. Hansen tied with Kulish up there, so we'll try and get another, you know, just keep it going with Pro and get another good series in and sort of maintain their advantage at the top.
Nice turn off with 10.5 for Kulish. He's kind of shaking his head about that, though. 10.3 for Hansen.
Yeah, it'd be great to see what conditions are doing down there, whether it's settled down a little bit for Prone. All eight of them starting with a 10 on that first shot, so. All right, Kamenskiy, you're getting a slow start there with a 10-0 and a 9.9. You won't want to shoot too many more of those in these final few. Bubnovich has got a really great group going on there. 10-7 for his last shot. And he's got two more, but three really solid 10s to start.
What is the most outrageously high series that you've seen shot before?
Well, I've definitely seen people go over a 53, so that's shooting a 10-6 average for their five shots. Can't remember exactly, but I think we've seen a couple of 53s on the World Cup circuit this year. You know, so you just, you know, if you shoot two or three in and around that area, you know, suddenly you're shooting, you know, really high total to really build some ground. So, you know, Prone's definitely, like all the positions, somewhere where you can make up ground there. Campriani, you know, 10-6, 10-7, 10-5, 10-9, you know, one more. Let's see, yeah, he's got a 10.3, we'll give him a 53, and that's definitely going to move him up a little bit. So Kula shaking his head, not too happy, but he's still in a good position. So we're just waiting for a few more shooters to finish up, and then we'll get the totals after the prone position.
Yeah, we have Campriani there finishing off with a 10.6.
There we go, a 53.3. And that's moved him right off the bottom. So
that's a beautiful
way
to go.
The comeback has begun.
Now we've got Kamenskiy holding on to first place, 0.8 of a point ahead of Shu. Kulish is in third place. And 0.4 of a point behind him, we've got Bubnovich. Hansen is in fifth place. And like you were just saying, Campriani with that 53.3 has jumped him up from eighth place to sixth place. And this is what you can see with Campriani in the past, is he has a way of climbing up the scoreboard. And you might think, maybe he's going to be out, maybe he's not, and then all of a sudden things start to happen, they click, and it works out for him.
Absolutely, you never know, and you know, he's just a little bit ahead of Lujanets too, who's been, you know, the form shooter of this year, you know, winning medals at World Cups. I think he's also the final world record holder, so shooting, he's been shooting some really, really good finals as well, so you know, he's not out of it. They're all still in the mix. You definitely rather beat Kamenskiy, Shu, or Kulish right now.
Of course.
At Kamenskiy, you know, a 308.3 is a really, that's a really good total. If he can even build on that, and sort of, you're basically looking at your points above a 10.0 and trying to get to, you know, if you're getting to 9 or 10 points above a 10.0 average, you're going to be hard to beat.
So what's going on now, Jonathan? What are they doing? They're changing things over?
Yeah, so we're really very similar to the last changeover. This one, they get a little bit more time, so we've got 9 minutes for this changeover. But same thing, the prone sights are coming off, the prone butt plate, prone cheek piece, and setting it all up for standing. You know, you're in a very, very different position from lying down on the ground. Your head position is very different. When they're standing up, the setup of the rifle, it has to be completely different. So again, lots of changeovers, lots of different pieces of equipment being changed. See one of them there, I think Kamenskiy bringing his stand back out, so they'll have their stand up there to rest their rifle on to take breaks. They'll have to get their prone mat out of the way. So lots of little things, even on their jacket, this thing's going to come off. They'll have to zip up the legs of their trousers, do their buttons fully up for standing. So lots of little things that takes a little bit of time. And again, the quicker they can do it, the more sighter shots that they're going to get. So It's very nice that the ISSF gave us 2 extra minutes in this changeover from the last one.
Right.
It's still not a lot of time, though. And standing, especially if you've got your heart rate up and you're a little nervous, you know, it may take a little bit more time just to calm your position down. You know, no sling to support you. You're just standing there, you know, with the rifle. You know, and it's a hard position. So.
And what do you do, Jonathan, to calm yourself down after you have gotten everything changed over, and you're ready to start your sighters?
I say prayers. No, I'm kidding. you know, just try and breathe. Try and just take some deep breaths. You know, you're focusing on your balance. There'll be probably going through their position and thinking about the different parts of their body and just trying to, you know, take a handful of deep breaths, get their mind focused on, you know, their pre-shot routine or some aspect that's important for them. But yeah, I think ultimately, you know, breathing's one of the things that helps us relax and trying to clear the mind and get the mind on the present and not be thinking, you know, what's about to happen or, you know, what they've just done in kneeling or prone or anything, and just try and get as focused as they can.
How hard is that not to think about what's coming up? I mean, they now just have 2 series, and after those 2 series, 7th and 8th place will be eliminated.
Yeah, it's definitely difficult. You know, I think that's a huge part of our sport is the mental aspect. You know, your self-talk and what you say to yourself. So it's important to, you know, you don't want to have too many negative comments or just, you know, focused on things that aren't going to help you or that you can't control. So the mental game is a big part of it. You know, these 8 guys should all be experts in this from the scores that they had to shoot to get into this. But the finals are a little bit different. The 3 medalists at the end are going to be the ones that, you know, really... you know, shot great, but also were really in control of their emotions and their, you know, their focus and everything else.
Is there some type of mental training that the athletes take part of?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of mental training that you can do for your sport, for the sport. A lot of them will use sports psychologists and mental training techniques in some way. You know, there's huge variety in that, but it's definitely an important aspect, and I'm sure a lot of the shooters here today will have used a lot of that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So yeah, we're looking at just over 4 minutes left. A few of them are getting in position. No one's got a shot off yet, but so there's Campriani there just doing the last couple of things, getting his glove on. And I think that is Hansen there, the first to get a sighter off. And, you know, just under 4 minutes left, still plenty of time, but, you know, typically in a match, you know, some of these shooters may have taken up to 10 minutes to do their sighter shots and
right.
Settle in. So now it's being reduced to, you know, 2 to 3 minutes and maybe even less in some cases. So that's very different from the match. So again, part of why they, you know, may well have done some training for these finals.
You know, we're down to 3 minutes and 20 seconds left over, and only Kamenskiy and Hansen have got a shot in so far. Everybody else has not. Hansen just got in a second. Now we've got Kulish going into it as well.
Yeah, it's really interesting seeing the TV camera view and things that you don't always see as a spectator, and so it's some really good images here and seeing the different equipment and positions that they have.
Shukinan right there. He still has not taken a shot, and we've got under 3 minutes now.
Yep. Campriani as well, waiting to get that first sighter. So there's Shu on screen. And for those that can't see, that was a 9.0. So pretty close. Couple more shots, and I'm sure they'll all want to shoot at least 1 or 2 10s before they go into the match, and not only to make sure they're sighted in, but just, you know, once you shoot that 10, it just gives you that bit of confidence, and okay, I'm in the middle, shot the 10, kind of, I'm ready to go, as it were. You know, there's nothing worse than shooting, you know, 3, 4, 5 shots, and they're all round 9s, maybe an 8, you know, all round the 10. You know, that's hard to keep your calm and, you know, know, still remain confident going into the match shots.
And what are we looking for now? What would be a respectable series of shots, and what would be a respectable shot itself?
Well, I mean, any time you shoot a 10 and standing is pretty solid. I think these guys shot incredible scores, you know, in and around the high 380s in qualification to make it here. But the final is definitely, you know, a different situation. It's a bit quicker, it's under time, obviously more pressure. I think, you know, if you're averaging a 10 and you're shooting over a 50, you're not going to be losing too much ground. If you're shooting a bit higher than that, you'll certainly move up the leaderboard. And a lot of the time, just as we saw in the women's final, trying to avoid any, you know, really wild shots. It's always possible to see, you know, certainly eights, but even sixes and sevens. That's certainly going to cost you quite a lot. So, you know, a bunch of 9-9s, 9-8s aren't going to hurt you too much, but these guys are quality shooters, so I'm sure there's going to be some of them that shoot some great standing 51, maybe even a 52, lots of 10s, and they're the ones that are going to move up or stay near the top of the leaderboard.
This is the thing about this event, is that if you do have one bad shot, that can bring you right down the leaderboard in an instant. And you can't afford that, basically. After the standing position or the series, then we're going to be going into single shots. And after each shot, the lowest person on the scoreboard is going to be eliminated.
Yeah, and it's so close right now. Like, you know, we're only looking at, you know, less than 4 points between, you know, first to eighth. Yeah, you shoot a seven and you're going to be right down at the bottom in a hurry. So, yeah, they're going to do two series of five shots. Like you said, they're going to get 4 minutes and 10 seconds. So a little bit longer than the other positions, and that's still averaging out at 50 seconds a shot. After that, they'll then go into the one shot at a time series.
So the wind looks like it's died down just a little bit from last time that we saw it, but that doesn't really mean much of anything. It can change on a dime here.
Absolutely. You know, and interestingly, even, you know, that's the front flag right in our picture that looks pretty calm, and the back flags are moving around a little bit. And that also happens in this finals hall. They're able to close the doors and in this same finals hall shoot air rifles. So the first 10 meters of this hall is definitely more sheltered, roof on it. And so you can see that, I think, with the flags, that the second wind flag that's further out is getting more impact from the wind. So it'll be up to them maybe to look maybe a little bit more at that far flag.
Okay, Kamenskiy, who is holding on to first place at the moment, let's see how this first series goes for him.
Yeah, he's had a great world championship so far. I mean, shot really, really well in pro. And like we said, ended up fourth and had a great match today. So started with a 9-0 there. Won't want to shoot too many more of those. And Kulish, you know, the youngest in the final, but he's super cool and calm. And, you know, I've seen him shoot quite a few finals in the last few years. And for a young guy, I mean, very confident and very calm.
And he's got the future wide open for him. Campriani started off with an 8.3. We don't see that right now on our screen, but just to let the viewers know, it's not the way to start off in the standing position, unfortunately.
No, especially with a lot of them shooting 10s. So Kamenskiy's 9-0 and Campriani's 8.3. The rest of them are shooting either high 9s or low 10s. So there's Shu there with a 10.0. Interesting, you know, he's one that shoots with no blinders, you know, around his face other than on the rifle, no visor, no hat. I'm sure the cameras enjoy that a lot more to see a lot more often, but a lot of us like to have visors or glasses. See Hansen there has the glasses frames and the visor.
Let's just talk about that just briefly, Jonathan. For people that don't know this sport, what is this all about? What is the visor? What are the glass?
Well, it takes away a bit of glare from, in this case, you can see there's some overhead lights. It also enables you to put some blinders up in there it's sort of like a horse blinders, you know, it gives you that tunnel vision and allows you to focus a little bit more, and it takes away the distractions from the side, so that can certainly help.
Oh, 7.7 for Campriani.
Yeah, you can see he's frustrated and working with his position, so it's going to be hard to come back from that. We'll see how he can respond for the next couple shots.
Kulish coming off that 8.9 with a 9.5. We saw quite a few in the 8 ring. For the third shot, let's just see how the rest of this pans out.
Yeah, I don't know if we're going to have anyone over 50.0, so definitely mixes things up. But it just goes to show as well, it's a tough position, and a tough situation as well. Bubnovich, 8.3, but he packed it up with a 10.7 and finished with a 49.1. So I think the shooting in the up in the 49s is still going to help you out. Lucian hits there with an 8.7. So
that's a surprise to you, Jonathan, to see the shots in the 8 ring and the 7 ring?
Well, I'm no stranger myself to a few 7s and 8s in standing. So, it's easily done. And, a situation like this, the last handful of shots, to win a world championship, it's a massive pressure situation. We, again, don't really see what the wind flags are doing down there, but a little bit of wind as well. So I think mainly just, these guys can shoot 10s all day long in training and even in the qualification. But I think this is just, situational, a lot of pressure, and it's tough.
So after this series in standing, we have Shu has overtaken Kamenskiy by 0.2 points. Bubnovich is in third place, 1.2 points behind Kamenskiy. Kulish in fourth place, only 0.4 points behind him. Let's focus in on Campriani just for a second again. It's not over by any means for him. He's only 0.4 points behind Lucianets. We do still have this last series to go. If he can get it together, and we know he can do it, he could move up the leaderboard.
Yeah, he's definitely not out of it. It's interesting on the screen there. You can see the overall scores, but the bottom three there also had the three lowest standing scores, shooting in the 47s and Campriani 46.9. So they can turn it around, but it just shows how important standing is. The three at the top shooting 49, 48, 49. So surprisingly that no one shot over 50. I'm sure someone's going to do it at some point in the maybe in this next series. They may have settled down a little bit now as well. They may have been able to just, all right, I'm sighted in, just take a few extra breaths. Just heart may have been racing, the mind may have been racing a bit. Now they can just focus in a little bit more. But you're going to have to move up the leaderboard. You're going to have to shoot a high standing, and those guys down at the bottom, this is it. This is their last, their next five shots to stay in the competition.
Let's focus in now on Lucianets, currently in seventh place. Starting at the 10.0.
Not too bad, 10.0 to start. Campriani here on 8.9, so Campriani not having his best day in standing. He shot great in the match to make it in here, and I think he'll be delighted to just be walking away with a quarter place, whatever happens.
Exactly.
But see if he can respond with some tens to finish. But yeah, it's probably going to be Lucianets then. It's trying to catch Hansen, Han the next one here. It's those guys that are in the most danger for this one. Oh, and Bubnovich shooting a 10.9. Han with an 8.9, so we're definitely seeing quite a lot of eights, but not a huge surprise for the situation. And right now, Kamenskiy and Zhu are still battling it out at the top.
They certainly are.
Yeah, that's not going to hurt you. 9.8s, 9.9s. Shoot a couple tens with that. Same for Hansen there, 9.7, 9.8, 9.9. He's going to want to shoot a couple tens, but he's not too far away. Nothing's too wild there. There we can see Hans just dropped down to six. So Lucianets trying to 0.8 behind, trying to catch up Han. He's going to have to shoot a few tens to finish. Hansen's going to want to just get a couple tens just to make sure he's safe. 9.8, shooting a really good group. And, in the match situation, that's four nines, and you can be kind of annoyed. In the final, you're getting, it's not really that much worse from shooting 10-0s and 10-1s. So, see, this could be Campriani's last shot of the final. He's probably going to have to shoot a really solid 10 and hope for a little bit of help above him.
That's not going to do it. The 9.6 for Campriani is just not going to be enough.
Oh, wow. So there's a few groans from the crowd. We're going to have a shoot-off. We have Campriani finishing in eighth, but above that, it is going to be a shoot-off.
Sis, we're going to be going into a shoot-off to find out who's going to be finishing off in seventh place. Hansen versus Luzhinets. Yeah, we were just talking earlier about how it's great when there's a shoot-off in rifle and pistol. In shotgun, we see that very often, but not so much in rifle and pistol.
No, you know, with the decimal scoring, not so much. And they only finished 2/10 behind Han, so Han survived by 2/10. And these guys will just do a one-shot sudden death to see who's eliminated in the seventh place. So
10.2 for Luzhinets.
Wait for Hansen.
10.1, unbelievable.
Oh, unlucky.
That is really just 1/10 of a point off.
And we'll see, you know, that Hansen loses out by 0.1 on that shoot-off. And we'll see what Luzhinets is able to do. He may be able to climb his way back up that leaderboard. He's really close to fourth and fifth.
So finishing off in eighth place, representing Italy, we've got Niccolò Campriani. And then seventh place, representing Norway, we've got Ari Hansen. Just missing that, just by 1/10 of a point over Luzhinets.
Well, I think both those two, they'll be disappointed, but they'll also be really happy to be leaving here with a quota place.
Absolutely. You know, it's really, really tight right now as far as this final's going. Kamenskiy's holding on to first place by 6/10 of a point, and Bubnovich is 3.5 points behind Chu.
Yeah, Kamenskiy and Shu have a nice little cushion there. Those two have sort of separated themselves, but the next ones, Bubnovich, Kulish, Han, and Luzhinets are all, you know, right there together, especially the bottom three, Kulish, Han, and Luzhinets. So any one of those could go out in this one. They'll want to shoot some tens, and, you know, you never want to say the top two, Kamenskiy and Shu, are safe, but They've got a nice little buffer there.
They really do.
You know, we could see those two battle it out over the next few shots to take the gold.
Now these guys are hearing exactly where they're standing. That puts a little bit more pressure on them. They can check out, you know, what's going on. And when you only have 2/10 of a point separating yourself from another, it's really anybody's game, and you just have to concentrate on shooting as deep as you can.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, you've got to maintain that focus. They hear the commentary. They also have another screen in front of them with the commentary as well, so they're going to know what's going on. So we've got Luzhinets on screen here, needing 0.2 to catch up with Han. I believe Han shot a 10.3, so we're looking for a 10.5. It's a 7.
7.2 to finish off. That's not where you want to be shooting at all.
So all five of the other shooters shot a 10 on that round.
So finishing up in sixth place, representing the Russian Federation, we have Nazar Luzhinets. He did win the silver in the 10-meter air rifle and the quota, so you do have to take your hat off to the guy. He did a great job this week.
Yeah, I mean, he's had an amazing year. Quota place here, a couple finals, a medal. He's been winning medals at World Cups. I mean, great, great talent, and we'll see a lot of him in the future.
Super nice guy as well.
Indeed.
Moving on now to find out who's going to be finishing off in fifth place, and it is Han and Kulish are going to be fighting it out. You know, also Bubnovich. Kamenskiy is still in first place by 7/10 of a point, and Chu in second place. What do you think is going to happen here, Jonathan?
Oh, not sure. Well, just looking at that, Kamenskiy had a 51.6 on that second series and a 50.8 from Zhu. So that's where they, you know, stretched their lead. You know, it would be great to see Kamenskiy come back after that disappointment in Prone and not only win a medal but win it all. Zhu's incredibly experienced as well, so you never know. So let's see. We've got Han needing to make up 0.3 over Kulish. 9.4, so Kulish just a 9 will probably be safe as long as it's above a 9.1. There it is, 9.5.
So finishing up in fifth place, representing the Republic of Korea, we have got Han Jin-sop going home with the quota place for the 2016 Rio Games.
So Kamenskiy was the only one to shoot a 10 on that round, and that actually gives him a little bit of a lead now, 1.1 over Shu with three shots left. There we can see it on the screen. But Bubnovich and Kulish really close for this bronze medal. So we're going to have the oldest against the youngest.
Exactly.
And 0.7, certainly catchable in one shot in standing. As we've seen, eights and a seven in there. You know, you never know what can happen in the last shot. So even for the top two, you know, they've got a nice little cushion, but one bad shot from them will put them right back in the mix with the other two.
Campriani's not looking very happy.
Okay, so Kulish looking for 0.7 to catch up with Bubnovich. So you'd think he probably needs to shoot a 10, but...
10.0 for Bubnovich.
So
Kulish at 10.6.
Oh, 10.6, and he needed a 10.7.
Just missing it by 1/10 of a point. Unfortunately for Kulish. Finishing off in fourth place, representing the Ukraine, we have Sergei Kulish.
So he'll be disappointed not to win a medal, but you know what? He'll also be delighted to have won a quota shot as well as he did today.
And we've got Kamenskiy, who's lost his great lead
that he had. I don't think he even realized that he'd been eliminated. He wanted that medal so badly, he
was just
going to stay
there.
He was not
going to leave. You can't make me leave.
I wouldn't want to leave either.
I wouldn't either. Going home in fourth place is a tough one. Just missing the podium.
Yeah, Kamenskiy actually had an 8.4 on that last one. So we can see there he's still in first place, but only 0.2 difference now. So really close. Bubnovich, he's 3.2 behind Zhu. So he's looking for some sevens out of the other two. Probably not going to see it, but we never know. He's guaranteed himself a medal, so... you're in a good position there. You don't have any expectations to make up 3 points, but you've got your medal and you can enjoy this last shot if it is his last.
The pressure really at this moment is on Kamenskiy and Xu. Only 0.2 of points separating the two of them. But let's just take a look at Bubnovich. .9 is not going to do it.
What have we got from Zhu? A 9.9. And what are we going to see from Kamenskiy? A 9.4. So might have a change in the lead now.
We do. We've got Xu, who is now overtaken. But first of all, let's just talk about our bronze medalist representing Belarus. We have Vitaly Bubnovich. He won the bronze in 10-meter air rifle this week, and now the bronze again. He's had a fantastic time here at the World Championships.
Yeah, I mean, making all three finals is very, very impressive at these championships. Shot an 11.81 to qualify today, so just an all-round incredible week. And two medals, quarter place, great week for him.
One more shot to go for the gold, and it's tight. Jonathan, only 0.3 of a point behind Xu, overtaking Kamenskiy on that last shot. It's anybody's game.
Yeah, I mean, this will be great redemption, I think, for Kamenskiy. Xu, you know, would be a great accomplishment, too. He's a former Olympic champion in air rifle. He's been one of the best air rifle shooters, I think, ever. But he's really demonstrated to be a great 3-piece shooter as well over the last 4, 5, 6 years. So... both looking to be the world champion. So what do we have? 0.3 difference. Kamenskiy trying to make 0.3. 9.4. So only a 9.2 needed for Xu. It's at 10.3. And you can see the reaction there. He's pretty excited.
Absolutely thrilled with that last shot. 10.3 gets the gold for Xu Qingnan from the People's Republic of China. Fantastic shooting, overtaking Kamenskiy at the very end of this final. Really, really great shooting from Xu Qingnan.
Yeah, great job. I think Kamenskiy will still be delighted to get a medal, having missed out in prone.
And our silver medalist representing the Russian Federation, Sergei Kamenskiy. Let's take a look. There they are, our finalists. Xu Qingnan, Sergey Kamenskiy and Vitaly Bubnovich are our medalists today. All of them going home, everybody today in today's final, going home with a 2016 Olympic Games quota place. Really exciting final today. All happened in the last two shots, and this is what the excitement of shooting is all about. Jonathan, I want to thank you for joining me again today. I wish you all the luck coaching at West Virginia University and also in your future.
All right. Well, thank you for having me again, and great final to watch, and great excitement as always.
Congratulations, everyone, on a brilliant final to the medal winners, to the athletes. Thank you to you for your support and encouragement once again. Please join us in the awards plaza very shortly, where we'll begin the victory ceremonies for the medal winners here. Thank you once again, and gracias.